I take it, Bo, you've been explained what's going on as well, like what we're doing, Shane. I'll take it Joe's explained everything to you.
Well, yeah, sort of. Yeah. He's, but I think you and him have probably had more chats about it than I've been party
Yeah.
to,
Now we're recording, I suppose. I'll introduce it so everyone can know. So Joe, this is Joe's idea. I just offered to help with him, but he said, like, with the 40th year, obviously everyone can't see each other. We thought, what, is there something that we can do that's a bit different? And this is obviously, it's not a fundraiser or anything like that. We're not going to charge people to watch it, especially you two, because we wouldn't get money. But I mean, it'll
You'll
be,
be
and you're,
paying me.
yeah, used to be and be paid as well. But it was just a case of, so what can we do something different? And Joe thought of a Hall of Fame, probably from his love for wrestling, because obviously they do that every year, don't they? The WWF Hall of Fame.
Yep.
And I said, I'm more than happy. You know, I'm like Shen, I'm more than happy to sit and talk shit with everyone for as I'll do it for a job. So what's it on a Sunday morning for an hour or whatever, however long it takes. And we spoke with your brother Gary, Kurt, around what can we do as a sort of the launch of the Gorsbrook Hall of Fame. And the two of you were very much put to the forefront of launching the cricket club that obviously the three of us and everyone who's going to watch it are part of and have loved for X
Yeah.
time. So it was just a case of, Gary, did you get my three questions that I'm
I
going
did. I got
to
them this
ask?
morning
Yeah,
and
perfect.
text to
So
Jen.
everyone who I'm interviewing, I'm going to ask the same three questions too. But then for everyone else, I'm really going to just give you guys the mic and you can sort of talk a bit about, well, for you, obviously the club and your involvement in it, but it'd be different for everyone. But that's what we're going to do. So officially, I'm not actually sure. What are your numbers for the club? Because was it done in bat? It would have been done in batting order, wouldn't it, for the first ever game?
No, it's
No,
alphabetical order.
done in
Oh, right,
registration
okay.
level, isn't it?
No, it's alphabetical order in the game that you play.
Was that on surnames or
Yeah,
for?
it's surnames, yeah.
Yeah. So what would you won then, Dean?
No, I'm number 10. I'll tell you the story in a minute, yeah. What
What
number are
your
you, Gary?
number 10? Your
There's a
surname's
story as well.
B. Yeah, well, that's nuts. All
Gary, what
right.
number are
It was
you?
a signing on number, wasn't it?
No, it was that's how we did it. It was alphabetical numbers. And the first game, Joe, they played London Marshes away, and I had to work on the. It was on a Saturday. I had to work, so I didn't go. And they went to London Marshes, and I believe, like, say, three or four cars, and one of the cars got lost en route and never made it to the game. So they had eight players that were down to play, and Tony Harris, who was going over to watch, and he was driving some of the lads over there. Tony ended up, they got him some spare whites and that, and Tony played. So they had nine players in the first game. So in the second game, B for Barwick, that's why I was number 10.
Ah, right. That makes a lot more sense. I was thinking, have we got a lot of Adams and Ahmeds who ended up playing in the first ever game or something like that? But no, that makes a lot of sense. So H Bomb went from security to security slash hooligan to number nine.
Yeah, Tony, whatever, Tony is living in Clacton now.
Legendary.
Whatever, whatever you say, Tony's history, he'll always be in Gorsbrook's first ever side.
That's brilliant.
He claimed to fame.
That's quality. That's quality.
No longer a Dagenham boy, but he'll
And
always be a
how
Dagenham
did
boy.
the club, like, what, when did you think, because obviously you were all been friends before, so when
Yeah.
did it go from, we'll do this, I'll take you, Dean, just went down the pub one day and go for a laugh, let's start a cricket team. Would have been playing cricket some sort before, right?
We were playing cricket every literally waking hour in Gorsebridge Park because, as part of Maggie's generation, none of us had jobs, and so everyone below us and below we were just going over the park and playing cricket from 10 o'clock in the morning to in the summer to like 10 o'clock at night.
How old would you have all been, roughly? I think you'd have all been sort of
I think
similar.
we were about 16, 15,
Yeah.
16. We
Well,
probably started
we was
cricket
playing
before
cricket
that.
before that, Gary. We was playing over the park before that. But
But I think,
during our teams, Gary's right. That was when the club was really, if you like, if you look at the nursery for the club, how it was built and the players that ended up playing, then they, the one thing we had in common, we used to play opposite Gary and Lawrence's house in Gorsbrook Park. Just across and over, and you had all the people that live around the park, and Steve Martin, Rook and Andy, Mickey Livett, and Georgie Morgan, and we used to bring a team over from Tilney Road, and we used to play like a mini test match against them, you know.
So it was like the cricket version of West Side Stories, basically.
Yeah, so we knew them guys, and they all became mates, and you know, we used to play cricket against them. And I mean, there were some pivotal figures over there who never ended up playing for Gorsbrook. Yeah. I can think of the Robertson family, Brian and Mickey, and they were over there every day. You know, they used to buy all the gear, and they was all, Brian was always buying stuff and that, you know. And they moved to Upney, and they just didn't come over so much, and they gradually sort of broke away from it. And when we started, they weren't part of it, you know, but they were instrumental in you know.
So there's a lot of people, involved who a lot of people would probably never even know about.
No, a lot of people wouldn't know them, you know. The people from the park would, but it was there. But, you know, and you had the Morrison family. So we had Fred and Tommy, who were like, and Roy Mercury as well, and Johnny Page. We had some sort of older guys, some adults, who, you know, if you like to sort of make sure we behaved ourselves and kept a little bit of organisation and discipline in the ranks, and just having some older guys there, you know. And when the club started, those four were all part and parcel as well. So, you know, we weren't all teenagers. There were some dads that, you know, that were sort of came over and that. And, you know, and those guys ended up, of course, becoming great friends of all the younger lads, drinking buddies, etc. So, as we all got older.
How easy was it to then, so you obviously decided, well, let's make Gorsbrook obviously named after the park that you played in. And how easy was it to actually make it an official club in comparison to obviously what you go through and the rest of the committee shan nowadays? Was it a lot easier back then?
Well, it was really, it was Peter White, who was a friend of ours, who was playing for a club. He was playing for Cranham, and he was a good player. And so I think we went to a function, and their secretary was there. And we'd already decided we were going to ask how the hell you
was
do
that,
this.
Was that Stan, Gary?
No, I think his name was Len, but it might have been Stan, actually.
Anyway, sorry, go on.
We literally collared him in the corner and said, well, what do we do? How do we get this going? And he said, well, you need a set of rules, and this is how you get the rules, and then you go into this place and, you know, you get some fixtures and you need to get a ground and stuff. And then we started talking about how you do it, you know, and how we're going to be wandering. And so then we all got together, a few of us in the pub, and started saying, well, are we really going to do this? And then we did. We just said, all right, come on, let's get it going. We've had great fun over the last couple of years doing this. Let's actually carry it forward.
And we had our first AGM in the Checkers pub, which is now gone, but that was
that's the one that, by Crowland's, isn't it? Is that the one on the corner?
It's at the Checkers, you know, where the Heathway joins Ripple Road. It used to be over on, if you're coming up from the Heathway station towards Dagenham Dock, if you like, at the big junction.
So I'm going in the right. I'm going in the wrong direction. Yeah, I know where you're
going. Pub it was, and it used to go right along, and it had all these little different alcoves and bars, and so he let us go in one of the quiet bits out the back, and we had our first AGM there. And then we said, anyone who wants to come, you know, join this and make this serious, you know, you've got to come along and we'll see what gauge the support and commitment.
Yeah.
And, see how much money you're willing to.
I can remember Fred Morrison was sitting there with a book and writing out all the, you know, everyone. And Martin Rook was the first person to pay him his subs, you know, because we said, well, we'll have a, let's say, a joining on fee of £10. We had to get some money together, buy some equipment, join the affiliations and that. And just adding what Gary said, the guy from Cranham gave us a lot of help. And another guy who gave us a bit of help, Gary, was Chris Stewart from Wigan Poland.
Yeah, he did as well.
Yeah, Chris used to be the umpire and fixture secretary for old Bancroftians. And Chris worked with Gary and I. When Gary says none of us were working, we were working at Wigan Poland, insurance brokers in Barking. And Chris was a colleague from work, and he just said, oh, I hear you want to start a team, and gave us some great advice. And he also told us to join the CCC and then go to the Bureau's fixture meetings. Do you remember, Gary, we went to the Royal Artillery Hall up in London. And we met all these other guys from all the clubs. It was very, you know, Gary and I
were quite daunting, though. Like, so you come from playing over the park. Yeah, playing from over the park. Yeah, to then going to places like that just to do. And you can imagine
Here we were, a few boys from Dagenham wandering into this place.
Yeah, exactly.
Just in our suits after work, thinking
we were fine. We were suited up and suited and booted, so at least we looked smart anyway.
So that we, you know, we could try and fit in. And then we walked into this place and we were wandering around for about 20 minutes, thinking, watching people doing it. And we were like, we've got to do this. We've got to get at least a fixture out of this.
What was it? You just go there. It'd be like you just go up to walk up to someone and say, like, what club are you from? Where do they play? Do you want to play this? It's a bit like a speed dating for cricket fixtures.
Yeah, but they had a commissioner in the middle. In one of these old boys that's been in the war and that with a suit on and the medals and that. He was standing in the middle and you had to look at the boards and the boards were up counties. So we were looking up on the Essex board and we saw a fixture. We looked at our dates where we had a clean. We weren't in the league or anything, so we had a clean fixture list. And we see, I remember Spartans was one of the first ones we saw, and it was a guy called Maurice Valdier. So we went over to the commissioner, and we said, we're Gorsbrook, we want to meet Spartan CC. And he'd shout out the top of his voice, Spartans, and then they put their hand up, and then you wander through all these hundreds of people and find that person, and then compare notes. And we went to the original meetings, and then over the years, we sometimes used to take someone else along with us. We took Fred along. We took Gary Parmenter along. Different meetings. And then we used to meet up with the boys from Surrey Overlights and go for a beer afterwards.
Yeah, wash your arm. If you're going all the way up to London, you might. I can imagine, like you said, you've got no fixtures booked in, but you can start haggling. So, 16th of April. I'm just going to, 1 second. Yeah, we are free, but let's just pretend we're important. Yeah, we can just in on that date.
That's exactly, I think that was
year
two.
Year one, we were biting the hand.
I'll move a few things around, but I think we can squeeze you in.
And also, they gave us advice, for example, if you get home, first of all, we didn't have a home pitch, but if we get home ground, you've got to provide tees. And our first home pitch was, believe it or not, up at Hainault Forest. And we had we had three games over there. And Gary arranged with, what was that pub called, Gary? The Oak, wasn't it? Along Wildbone Lane or whatever you call it. The road that goes over to Hog Hill, that main road there, upside of Hainault Forest. And there was a pub there. It's gone now. And Gary arranged it with the governors in the pub there, the couple that run it. And they, instead of having a tea, we provided some drinks and that in the tea break. And we told the other team we'd take them back there after. And we had a big buffet laid on and that. And it was
cool. That sounds better than it is nowadays, Shane.
Well, we haven't got tea.
I've forgotten that.
Birdie does that anyway, Shane. He has three pints of Guinness at half time anyway.
we'll tell you about that as this goes on. But, Gary, you arranged that. You always had a sort of handle on the teas, and even when we first started doing them, you were like one of the main protagonists, weren't you, for getting teas done and that, especially when you got your own place. You used to have someone from the club.
Oh, yeah, that's a lot later.
Do you remember? I'm saying, but over the years it developed. Yeah. You always had a keen slant on the what we should and shouldn't have for teas.
That's because you couldn't find anyone else able to do it. That was the thing.
Yeah, we had mums doing it. The mums were taking turns, you know, originally. And then when Gary moved to Barking.
I sound like fucking it.
You just dropped off. We can still hear you. Your camera's just dropped off. That's all.
Yeah, come back. Yeah,
you no were worries. Always. I know, Gary. You had we used to take turns and put someone to go round to Gary's, and Gary obviously ended up becoming a chef like years later. But he always had a penchant for cooking and that. And they used to come up with some great stuff. But you always had the booby, Gary. Do you remember the sandwich with the chilies in or whatever?
That's all right. We put something in, somebody would always get it. It was always someone like Gary Palmer, wasn't it? Would always get it. Who you didn't want to get it would be Rookie, because he would go insane when he got it.
I can imagine it'd be very like Tasmanian Devil, like if Rookie got it.
Complete Tasmanian Devil.
And was you playing, was it like, so starting off, was it even after you created the club, was it friendlies a lot of the time, or did you go straight into a league?
It was friendlies for probably 3 years.
Yeah.
And then we've been talking to a guy, and he ran a league. It was two divisions, I think it
Colin,
was.
Yeah, Colin Bush, Gary, wasn't it?
Colin Bush, yeah. And we went into that one. And that was
comprehensive claims. Essex.
It was called something else before that, wasn't it, when we first...
It was Comprehensive Claims, and it was CCS.
CCS.
They abbreviated the company's name, didn't they?
Yeah.
Because Colin used to... Gary and I end up being on the league committee as well, and eventually in time, and Colin used to host the meetings at his office upstairs in Reed Road. He had an office over the top of the shops. We used to go there for our meetings, you know. It was cool. That was many years ago, Gary, wasn't it? Just thinking back, you know.
And when did the club expand into multiple teams then, gents?
Oh, not for a long while after that.
It was about 99 when the railway stroke Essex Taverners team, we played in friendlies, and we played them towards the end of the season, and we were sitting in the bar after, and someone said that they were worth travelling to Brentwood to play cricket for Essex Taverners, and they'd like to, you know, come back playing local again like they originally started up at the railway over Lays, and they asked if we could, you know, join the clubs up, sort of thing. So they came and joined us, and Dave Whisker, with help from people like Barry Lisbon and Paul Winsley, and, you know, with some of the Winsley brothers, they all had kids and that, and they started off a cult section, but with the injection of the those adults, we were able to easily field two teams in the league the following season. And Dave was captain of the Saturday second team. And a guy called Barry Miles was the captain of the Sunday second team. And I started playing for the Sunday twos as one of the sort of people to try and integrate it a bit, you know, and it was mainly made up with their guys. But and they retained a lot of their fixtures, you know, so... for continuity in that, and then it all started with the Colts, especially. It just all started gelling, and we never looked back, really. You know, so
that's to me. That's when the club becomes. It goes from mates who started something a bit seriously to becoming a proper establishment. I've never thought I'd describe Gorsbrook, especially coming from me, and proper establishment name. Some of the clowns that I know from the club, but
yeah, you're right, yeah.
But that's when it became. Obviously, something really serious. You still with us, Gary?
Is he frozen?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll be back in a second.
I didn't know if you could still hear us or not.
The later years, Joe, are quite well documented, and most of the people on here will know about the, you know, the sort of the noughties, the tens, and the, you know, and into the 20s now. I mean, Gary and I, we, you know, there's a lot of stuff that, because we never had the social media stuff that we've got now. I mean, imagine years ago, Gary, if we had Facebook and WhatsApp and you know, Instagrams and all these other, you know, mediums that people post films and photos on. We had people in the club that used to take photographs, and the Walshes were quite prolific at that. Steve Brooker, there was a few, you know, I think Gary Palmer, Terry King. So even now there's a set of, you know, everyone's got a set of photographs in existence of particularly the tour games. I think the tour was what took Gorsbrook from being a park side to being a really, I thought, established club. Was in 1985, we went on our first tour, and that was 85, wasn't it, Gary, I think?
Yeah, I think it was 85.
Yeah, 85. Yeah. And you know, just being away on tour playing cricket, we couldn't believe it.
Where to,
it,
Shan?
Know. Sorry?
Where to?
We went, tour was in Norfolk. We stayed up. We were based in Great Yarmouth.
Yeah,
and that was our base for many, many years. We carried on going up there to Yarmouth till, you know, well into the 90s. And we went, you know, after that we had a couple. We stayed in Norwich, and then subsequent tours, people, you know, modern players will remember going, for example, Isle of Wight three times, Harrogate, a couple more to Norwich. So we've continued the tour. Although not as frequently, we used to do one every year, but it's still, you know, still like a vital part of Gorsbrook's fabric going on tour. Because it used to make, if you imagine, you're all away on a holiday, really. It is a holiday together, but you're playing cricket. And those friendships become, you know, even more sort of concrete. And then you go on, you know, years to come, you'll always be mates, and you'll always have stories to recount about the tours. It's some great memories.
Yeah, and if people made themselves unavailable for the tour because they were going off with their girlfriends and Bennett on, you would get slaughtered for about 3 months before the tour.
I agree though, and obviously it'd be different to when you boys were going on tour. But like even now, I think back to, you said Norwich. So I think back to when we went on tour to Norwich, and my first memory is, I have two memories, and they involve my dad and Paul Calverley. So they don't involve people my age, but it's Paul Calverley running around that Mercy nightclub, smashed, chasing the bloke who had the Sambuca bottles, pouring it down everyone's neck. But Paul Calverley was just chasing, and it's like a Carry On. All you needed is that da-da-da-da-da-da-da music over the top. And he was just getting three Sambuca poured down him. And it was after that, it must have been 3 o'clock in the morning, there's one bar in the whole street that remained open. We've stumbled out, everyone stumbled out. So it's like people my age, I would have been maybe 16 to 18 then. And you got like Jordan Calverley, similar age, all the dads, mums and dads. And then we stumbled across, my dad's already in the only bar that remains open. And he's been in there for half an hour. He's plotted up to get everyone a space for when we went in there. And I just, so it's like two generations of different people on this tour. That's exactly. So, but was it when you boys went, was it more like just the people your age, or was there the people who went as well, even back then?
Yeah. Well, I think Fred came on to
it. Was Tommy. Tommy came on to it.
And of course, people like Lee Barwick came, and Lee at that time was
Danny Walker.
They were literally 15, 16, they weren't even 16, I don't think. They were at school. And they were blitzed most of the time. And they were the worst people to try and get back into bed at like 2 o'clock in the morning.
Whenever I think about it, you say that now, I just think it is very, what's it, the Jolly Boys outing, isn't it? But for cricket, it is exactly that, isn't it?
Yeah,
right, serious drinking sessions gone on. You know, you look back now. I know they say there's no pride in drinking and all that, but God, we had some great times. And of course, the more we got drunk, the sillier things happened. And you know, so, but it was never the one thing about Gorswick was never nasty. Everyone was always friendly, and if anyone did sort of look like they were gonna, I don't know, overstep the line, you had all the lads to bring you back down again. No one ever thought they were Billy Big Shot because.
Yeah.
You had people that were so dry to put you down in the club. You know, nothing like Steve Brooker, a one-liner would kill you, you know, if he was playing up. And you, honestly, it was great. It was self-moderating, the club, you know. You never had any... Yeah. No one was a star in our club. Even though we had some brilliant cricketers, you know, but we were...
Even though someone was getting too leery, you'd send Wookie over to him and say, just have a word. And that was it.
Yeah, I think that's probably why, Shad. It weren't because you're a nice bunch of blokes. You had Jack there in the corner.
No, I'll tell you what.
Growling at people.
Now, Steve Rook, right? Steve, come on tour and whatever. Steve was an absolute great mate, and he was smashing. He'd do anything for anyone, you know. And Steve was always... I don't think, apart from one game at Blythewood, I don't think I've ever seen Steve drunk. He always used to... He could drink all night, and he never used to, you know, change his mood. And he was always sensible. And if there was, you know, if there was going to be any trouble for him, he would quickly have a word with some bloke from the other mob. We'd all end up best mates, you know. He had a knack for sort of seeing it and quelling it before it started, so to speak. Yeah. I don't know, but Steve used to be one of our great ambassadors. He used to make friends with the other side in the pub afterwards. He'd try and take the red off with bouncers, and you know, he was a really quick bowler. Steve was a great player. And we'd get in the pub afterwards, and these people who probably wouldn't even, you know, in the game, mated his guts. They were like best mates. And we go back the following year and we turn up and everyone would be, oh, you know, hello. And he made a sort of relationship and with the other club. And take Surrey Overlights. They've stood the test of time. We used to go, you know, Blythewood and that. And people loved us. Even though we played, you know, we used to say, play hard on the pitch, play hard in the bar. That was our, you know, it was one of our mentors, you know, so.
And you mentioned... Dean, you mentioned, just picking up on what you said there, that you had some quality cricketers. Who were standouts from, like, when you first started playing over the park to, like, creating the club? Who were the standouts?
What do you think, Gary?
Well, there's Lawrence.
Yeah.
Finest batsman I've seen, to be honest. No one who could, you know, it would not flashy, just accumulates.
Yeah.
But then you got to the stage where people like Darren Ivory would come in. And if you were at the other end of him, you just had to duck a lot because the ball would come straight back past your head. Everything straight. People like Darren, I thought, were just like, he had so much skill. You know, and Scott, who could bowl anything and would constantly bowl anything. So, yeah, there's some great players, you know.
Well, we had Scott and Steve Rook used to happen to bowling. And Steve Brooker used to come on first change, or often he'd open himself, you know, as time went on. And, you know, those three would have got in any team we played against. You know, the first few seasons, you know, see, Steve Rooks used to, one season he got 400s in a season, and, you know, that was unheard of in our club. And then years later, Lawrence got three in a weekend and banked on the weekend. And, it's always records are there to be broken. But, you know, as Gary says, we had those players when we started, I'd say, Steve and Lawrence in the first season, and not far behind them was Andy Livett. You know, Marv was a terrific all-rounder as well, and he bowled a slower ball, but his batting, he used to accumulate runs. And then you had the youngsters, like, we always had youngsters come through, younger brothers now, and Gary mentioned Darren and Scott, and then later on, Lee and Danny Walker, who, you know, were no mugs either, and there's always been like a conveyor belt, until Dave and them, and Barry and Winston and that started the cult section. We just relied on younger brothers or neighbours or, you know, relations kids or whatever. You just brought people over. And I always remember, fair enough, Gary, when your neighbours, Gary used to live next door to Angie, Darren Ivory's wife. And Angie's cousins came over from Australia to stay for the summer, Jamie and Danny. Do you remember, Gary?
Oh, yeah.
They brought them over. They came over the Nets, and these two kids, like, particularly Jamie, he was a bit older. And they, you know, they were awesome, and they just started playing for Gorsbrook, and it was funny. That was those our first overseas players, like, if you know, I mean, you know, proper serious overseas. And they went back, and then I think years later Jamie came back again and lived in UK for a while. But all the connections were in place, if you like. But we, you know, but to introduce youngsters and people that came over, you know, relations that were coming over from overseas, but not. Oh, so down the years, been some terrific players. You know, we've had wicket keepers. You know, we don't mention, for example, Dave Caruana was our first keeper. Sticky to his friends. He kept wicket for many years. And then, you know, in later years, you've had, you know, you'd say your friends like Chris Burke, who's you know, come along.
Yeah, and Adam Ivey.
Crabbe,
the club's always had at least one like star wicket keeper throughout. Yeah. I think throughout existence, isn't it, really? From going back to your time to and into like my playing generation. It sounds like at least it's I can imagine, whilst it must have been great because of the social side of things, but having quality players, so you're not turning up every week, getting smashed, but then getting smashed in the bar, that must really help, because it probably would have got to a point where it would have been quite demoralising just going out.
I'll tell you another person who's also had a great legacy on the club, particularly with late years with Colts and that, is Martin Rook. And Martin was about the first person in the club who won an external award. The recorder group in them days used to have so many different editions, you know, Romford Recorder, Barking and Dagenham Advertiser, but all around Essex and London, and, you know, and the Archer group had a Bowler and Batsman of the Month award. And Martin, I think, in 1 month had taken about 30-odd wickets. He was bowling, you know, sixes and sevens nearly every week in the league games, you know, and he was unplayable. And he was selected as bowler of the month, and it was a great award for the club, let alone Martin, you know, when he had to go and get his award and that. And the editor of the local group of newspapers was presenting it to him. And, I was proud. It wasn't me that won it, but I was proud for the club, you know, someone winning an award like that. I'm still thinking about that to this day. And, of course, Martin went on later on to be another pivotal person in the Colts setup, and again, people forget we're like racehorses. We sired, you know, the youngsters that come onto the club, and then of course Michael came into the club, Martin's son, and Michael was a great player himself. You know,
yeah, he wasn't bad.
Yeah, we've we've seen
something about this cricket club and being really good players but supporting terrible football teams, isn't it? Your brother Gary, I'm God forbid asking what team.
Wait,
oh, there you go. Yourself, your brother, Michael Rook, just supporting terrible teams. It's lucky your son supports West Ham, Dean.
Oh yeah, someone sell us that this is, you know, we've had our legs pulled throughout the years because we've been so, you know, we've been so poor really. And then when we win the cup one year, and everyone hears about it. But.
When was for the in terms of so cups then? When was the first like anything big for the club in terms of like competitions? Like if you won a trophy or got to a final or anything like that.
Well, Gary, you said yesterday. Funny enough, you were talking about something, and you mentioned something out of the blue. You know, Gary?
Yeah, and I couldn't remember what that was.
You remember we got to the final, and you mentioned it's one of your most memorable games, which you're probably leaving what Joe was going to ask anyway.
Well, it wasn't one of my memorable games, but it was for the club. It wasn't one I played in, it was one I umpired in. And that was a final at Old Church Park, and I'm trying to remember the competition. Was it evening 28?
It was a Smallcombe Sports League Cup. It used to be 40 overs and it was an afternoon thing when cricket used to be played a lot in the afternoons. You know, it was easy to get off work for half day and all that.
Yes, it was midweek, wasn't it?
Yeah, and all the league went in it and we were in Division 6.
That's right. And it was just a spectacular game because it was a really hot day over Old Church Park, and Old Church at that time was such a beautiful batting wicket. It was like concrete, wasn't it? Everyone scored runs on that wicket. It was a bowler's graveyard. But they got quite a big score, I think it was. It was Asians, or who was it, Jim?
The semi-final was against Bellis.
Bellis.
Yeah, we played Asians in the final, yeah.
Yeah, it was a semi-final against Bellis. And we were completely out of it. And then Rolf came in at like number 7. And Martin Rook came in at number 10. And hit them all over the park and won the game for us out of nowhere. And everyone went insane because it was like we're through to a final. It was a game that was just, we completely lost it. And we built it up to be such a big thing. And we're like, oh, we've thrown it. And then these two came out of nowhere, hit the ball over the park and won us the game. It was just stunning. Boy, was there a lot of drink done that night in that little clubhouse.
And give Bellis their due.
Yeah.
Bellis came up, you know, we had the bar over the top, the showers and changing rooms were on ground floor and the bar was upstairs. And Bellis stayed and had a beer with us after, despite the fact that they were like, you know, massive odds on favourites. They were in the top division, they say we were in Division 6, but, and they couldn't believe it. But we did know the Bellis lads anyway already. So if they'd have gone home, you know, they'd never heard the last of it. So they came up and got drunk with us. And then the final that year, Gary, was that was our first ever final for anything. And when we turned up to play Asians over Old Church, I remember I was up.
Oh, yes.
I didn't play in those games because I'd just had a knee operation. And I remember coming over, and Asians had two sides. They had literally 22 players there, and we were like, "What's going on?" They all had whites on as well, and apparently they got a load of ringers in, you know. And it was like if they'd won the toss, one team was going to play, and if they lost the toss, another team was going to play. And what they've done, they end up playing a few of the ringers and upset a few of their boys that have been playing all season, you know, left them on the side because some of them were sitting there talking to me and you know, voicing their displeasure because they've been part of, you know, fixtures and fittings all season and these superstars have turned up. And that's when they all started writing rules in about bona fide players and having to play at least two games in the cup competition and all that. Because people just abuse it and bring in superstars. And you know, our Asian Cricket Club at the time was so strong. Their second team would have beaten us without all these superstars. And they gave us a tanning. But, I mean, Sticky Steve Lister was about the only one that got any runs that day. But, it was a bit of an anti-climax, the final, when...
Yeah. What about you, Shem? What one do you remember then? What sticks with you?
Well, the Bellis game, I'll agree with you, you know, because Gary mentioned that yesterday, and I do agree with that game. And it's sort of for individual reasons, you can say, oh, yeah, my favourite game was that game. I remember the Greyhound game. I got my first 50 And the reason I remember it is, you know, ironically, yeah, all right, I got my first 50. But before the game, the ground was a bit damp. And they're catching a guy called Cliff. It was over at Greyhound, at North, over Perth Road, over at North London. And the ground was a little bit damp. And Cliff said to me, we'd better roll a wicket, get the damp out of it, because otherwise we won't be able to play. And Cliff and I, you know, on each end of the roller, we rolled the track before the game, about an hour before the game, so we're there early, and let it dry out a little bit. The sun got to it. And of course, you know, the rest is history. I got my first 50, and we
had coincidence, so that is.
For the rest of the season, he was trying to roll every single pitch.
Yeah. I reckon, Gary, what I reckon he did was he rolled the ends of the wicket away from the stumps so he could never get out.
But, that, you know, that purely a personal reason. But
only way that,
games at playing at Winchmore Hill for it. For, you know, Winchmore Hill was an awesome ground to go to. And I remember thinking, how did we get this fixture, you know, and we've got to go back next year. And, you know, and it's us lot a bit rough and ready and a bit quite posh over at Winchmore Hill. And, of course, again, we won them over because we went in the bar after and stayed there till closing time. And then the next morning, I'll get a phone call from the fixture secretary for Winchmore Hill confirming us for the two games the following season. So, then you'd have like... you might have 11 or 12 available each game, and then we're playing Winchmore Hill when 20 people were available. So the selection committee had its work cut out, who to leave out. You know, you pick people who've been doing work for the club. You didn't want to sort of leave them out because it was Winchmore Hill. It's like a prestige fixture.
Yeah.
But we only ever played them on friendly basis. It was they were in the Middlesex League, you know, but that was, again, another sort of memory of getting of different fixtures and getting games and that. And, you know, and I remember... I weren't playing, but Gary's first 100. And Louise and I were living at Shoebury Ness.
He has to get this in before I do. He
phoned me up on the Sunday night. Louise said, oh, Gary's on the phone. I think he sounds a bit drunk. And then he proceeds to tell me he's talking through his first ever 100.
And he was 11 points, you know, and I was, 200 minutes. 140 balls.
You must remember that game, though, Gary. That's got to be your most memorable
game. I don't remember a thing. I was too drunk afterwards.
No, I mean, you know, the innings itself, though.
Yeah, it is. I mean, you do remember things like that. And, you know, wasn't the greatest of batsmen, but when you get a ton, the first time you get a ton, everything just, it's like, the world's a better place. Everything is good after that.
Yeah, so, and Gary, no one can ever take that away from you. It's something I've never done, get 100. And
I do like to remind you of that regularly.
Sorry, yeah, my line just cut out, Shane. Can you say that again, please?
Please recall that.
But people that were there that day, obviously I wasn't there. It was on a Sunday, I remember, and I was in Tewbury. And I remember like listening to people that were there, and they said it was a brilliant, faultless 100. You know, it wasn't like a lucky innings or anything. Gary really played a top draw 100, so no one can ever take that away from him. You know, that's and it pains me to say that, Gary.
After all these years.
Yeah. And would those matches be your favourite personally? Those two games that you mentioned then. So the semi final for you, Gary, and the game around that 50, Daniel. Have you both got favourite matches that you've played in?
I think the Bellas game was like a great game for the club, and it was like a landmark game. We went on and played in other finals, and we won leagues years later and all that, you know. But I think that was sometimes a sort of turning point, wasn't it?
Well, it wasn't just the game itself, it was the whole thing around it. Sometimes you turn up at somewhere that you had no expectations from. You'd have a cracking game in a beautiful weather. Someone would lay on a magnificent tee. You'd be drinking in the bar, and then many of us would turn up about 10 o'clock to take you home, drunk as logs, and you're thinking, life doesn't get any better than that.
Yeah.
And then the next thing, you get up the next morning and start again.
Do it all over again.
I think we spent the 90s, the 80s and 90s, permanently drunk.
And then on Sunday night, I can always remember being at Winchmore Hill on a Sunday game, and Scott and Darren were sitting in the corner, and they'd both fallen asleep. And they'd been drinking all night, and they were like, you know, both of them were about 15 at the time, whatever. And Steve Brooker just tapped me on the shoulder and pointed at them, and he said, look at them two, they've got to go to school in the morning. And it just ran onto them. Nowadays, of course, if you know, people have got to be so careful with their licenses, and youngsters have to prove their identity with a you know, an ID card or whatever you have to have these days, you know, to prove your age. Whereas we were just taken on trust, and the youngsters with us were looked after. They, you know, even if they were at school and they didn't have a job, all the older lads used to buy them drinks. They just used to include them. And then years later, they would do the same for the younger lads. When they were older, they would buy the youngsters a drink and that, you know, they'd remember the Gorsebrook tradition.
It's crazy how you've just said like Dal and Scott, and you've got, you've, and
what, they're in their 50s
like,
now, aren't they?
And you'd bring, and you, they, like when you were younger going up, you'd bring your little brothers over or friends or random people who get shipped over from Australia for a holiday for 2 weeks. But you've got Ted coming through now, who I played a lot with last year. And I can tell he's going to be a little pain in the ass, no doubt, like Dal was growing up. But we just need to get him drinking more, because I don't think he takes beer. He's a bit of a soft lad. I think he's like a WKD sort of bloke at the moment. And then you've got Shane, who's an official pisshead, who obviously only plays for us on Sundays. But it's so even 20 years later, 30 years later, it's still the same, but the kids are coming through, even though Dal and Scott are old men now.
Yeah.
Actually, I'll take that back. Scott is, Dal won't. I see Dal a lot, and yeah, I'll re-edit that. I see Dal a lot, and he'll give me a slap around the head for that.
Talking of memorable games, Joe, another memorable game for me. You mentioned something earlier on about your dad coming on tour and playing in the team, that, you know. Well, obviously, my son Joe's now, you know, heavily involved with Gorsebrook. Joe's played well over 300 games for the club and senior, you know, let alone the Colts and that. And one of my memorable games was playing in the same side as Joe for the first time. You know, it's one of those things that you look forward to. And unfortunately, because of all these knee operations I've had, we never really got a chance to play that many games together. It was like not even a handful. I think it was about 3 or 4 games, if that. And I think the last time we played together was over at Loughton, and on the Sunday game. And Joe was Sunday captain. That's the last time. I think it's probably one of the last games I ever played. And, I, it annoys me when people now say, I can't be arsed and I can't be bothered to play in that. I would do anything to be able to play again, but I just can't. And Gary's over there in Australia, and I bet he'd say likewise, you know, he could probably play over there.
If the body was willing, you wouldn't play over here because everything comes at your head. Yeah. But, yeah, absolutely about that. And like, I think the last time I played was in that six-a-side competition, which would have been probably 10, 12 years ago when I came over for a holiday.
Oh, yeah, the club day.
Yeah.
That was
good. You were over on at the time from Australia, Gary, presumably.
That's it. All my kit was still in the UK, so I got hold of it.
But for those watching, Gary, when did you actually emigrate to Australia?
2005.
So 16 years ago. When you think, Joe, that's a long time, and yet Gary's got such a rich history of the club. You know, before he went, you know, he's 24 years service, and he's got so many memories and stories to recount. And
Started playing for the club when you left then, Gary. That's going to make you feel really old.
Oh, yeah.
Around 11, 12.
I think Chambers waited me. I stopped for a couple of years, and then Chambers waited me to come back and help Wookie out.
We're sure. You couldn't get a flight. I'll let you know on a Friday, so you should be able to get back in time. We've got a Sunday friendly.
I'm on the way.
Yeah, let me just pack my bags.
I'll just see you on the minibus for me. I'll be there.
another thing about Gary's family, of course, you've got the minibus used to leave outside Gary's house. So Brenda and Gary's late dad, Pat, bless him, they used to have all sorts of people get there early, traipsing into their front room, sitting there waiting for the bus to turn up. So like Saturday morning, their house was like almost like Gorsebrook's HQ, you know, and then coming back afterwards, they had to put up with all the drunken buffoons getting off the bus outside their place. And then the cricket gear, the big club bag, used to go into Gary's garden shed.
What's the name of the road? Is it Dagenham Road?
Dagenham Avenue.
Avenue, even that sort of. It's like this cricket club is so. I'll tell Hayley's stories about this and how I explain it to her when she starts coming over now and we play different clubs and how different, and I think this is a million times better than your massive clubs in Essex, like the clubs who are on the central line, Shan. So like your Loughton's, Buckhurst, Seals, all fancy clubs where you pick, people get paid to play and all that crap. But like, how stupid is it that a memory of how the top of Dagenham Avenue meeting, where obviously like you would have lived, Gary, your brother lived for ages, the Whiskers live now.
Morrison's, the cow.
Yeah, like how stupid our meeting at the top of that road is such a, like, an iconic place for a cricket club, whether it's for cricket matches, golf days, going to on tour, going to up London to watch cricket if we've organised a day out. It's just like, it's just so stupid. But I think I just love it. I think it's brilliant. But you wouldn't get that with some posh club that do all the fancy stuff. I know which side I would rather be on the coin anyway. But I think it's brilliant. And I can imagine, yeah, like your mum and dad, Gary, would have been seeing everyone's bright faces in the morning as they meet for cricket. And then the same faces have fallen asleep on your mum and dad's sofa because they're smashed when they get home.
But that happened a couple of times. The worst thing was the next morning when they turned up on the Sunday morning for the next game. And there would be, you know, you'd look at them and they're in a terrible state, but they're ready to carry on and start again.
I think it's just brilliant. And one of the other questions I was going to ask was for individually, so for both of you, what are your personal, like your best and favourite Gorsbrook memories? And it can be anything. It could be something that happened in the bar, Gary, your first ton or something like that. Shan, your first ton. Oh, obviously it can't be that. But what's a personal, your favourite Gorsbrook memory if you had to select one?
God. See, it's difficult. There were times when, like, I remember the first hat-trick and everyone going insane. And I remember the first ton. No, actually, I'll tell you what it's going to be. It's going to be rookie's ton in 27 minutes, which he did over
Valentine's Park,
over Valentine's Park in Ilford. And he hit this ton and every ball he bowled just went out of the ground, every single ball. 27 minutes for a ton. And I remember thinking at the time, this is just ridiculous. No one's going to believe this.
Brilliant. I wasn't in that game, but that was something else. It must have been, you know, people.
It was just like, you just had to go and fetch the ball all the time for someone else. Because they didn't know what to do because every ball was just smashed out of that. Actually, probably that is one, just, you know, sitting there watching it going,
Gary, didn't you say that game? I think you told me that that night, because I think I met him for a drink after work. I was working Saturdays quite a lot then, and I remember Gary saying that the boys on the next wickets, because they were playing in Valentine's Park, where there would be, like, you know, games on the adjacent wicket, not in the main arena, you know, on the outside pitches, and they all stopped on the next pitches to watch Steve eventually get to his 100. Everyone stopped the games and watched. You know, it was that astonishing. Really? And
it was just ridiculous. You know, it was just one of those things, and it was early in our career, or our team, and it just was just amazing to watch. So I think probably that. Now.
I know he's on the phone.
Oh, sell.
Yeah. So. One thing I'd say, my memories from Gorsbrook are probably, there's too many to sort of narrow one down, but I would say all the great friends I've made at the club because of the games and because particularly of the tours. But I've got, you know, I like to think I get on with everyone at the club. There's no one I disliked throughout the years. And my life is fuller through being a member of Gorsbrook Cricket Club, and I've made some great mates who are still mates now, particularly the early years, because the boys you make friends with in recent years, and the ladies, obviously, you know, women involved in the club, they're still current friends who I see, you know, all right, COVID allowing, in a normal summer I would see them at the club or matches or whatever, but the boys that used to play years ago, like Gary's the best example, sitting there now. Gary's in Australia and I'm here, but we're talking about something that is a great mutual love of ours. And we're so lucky to have made some such great friends at the club. And the list would go on if I was to try and name them all. But you know, and years later, and obviously my brothers, Scott and Lee, played. My late brother, Ricky, played. He was one of the original Gorsbrook crowd. We lost Ricky last year. We lost Steve Morrison, Victor's older brother. We lost Roy Mercury, Barry Lisbon recently. You know, and they're all those guys I'd like to remember because of all the, you know, the times at Gorsbrook. Great memories. And then looking forward, to say, we, what's it been for? I don't know what number, Joe will tell you what number we're up to now in terms of the club numbers and that, but we're so lucky to have had some great people come through the club and overseas players. You know, we said earlier about the Jamie and Danny being the first sort of pathfinders. And then years later, you've had people like Wayne Hutchinson, Rod Butchers, Peter and Rianne Schumer, Dave Popgeiter, Springbok, you know. I mean, Gal, we've had some good, you know, overseas lads have come through as well. Just, and they've done no more than perhaps look in the when we had the internet, look on there, put the postcode in of where they're staying with the relations, and up come the nearest club, Gorsbrook. Oh, I'll give that a go. And of course, you come over, and if you're particularly an Aussie or a South African and you like a beer, you've picked the right club, you know. And again, I bet those boys would say they all keep in touch now on Facebook and that. And you make life friends in this club, and I think that's my greatest sort of memory of the club is it's still all those old teammates and that who still keep in touch. And when we do get together or we talk, we always mention the tours. So I'd say the Gorsbrook tours are the thing that are most sort of fondest in my memory, I'd say.
I think for me, the question you'd sent was about who was your favourite person, who was your best mate, that type of thing. And I don't think it was ever one person, and I think it's everyone. And
yeah.
I think something like this, you know, if I went back to the UK now, I could catch up with like 90% of those people, and it would be like I'd gone, you know, I've been away for the weekend. Mm. You carry on where you left off. And when you build friendships like that, it's friendships for life, isn't it? And, you know,
yeah.
Here we are, all these years later, still friends.
still talking a load of old rubbish and laughing about it. You're spot on, though. And even like going back to what I said about like that Norwich tour, and my instant memories are of my old man and Paul Calverley, who would obviously a generation above me, that they'd be like your ages, the dads, if you like. But yeah. you mentioned Rod Shan, and Rod was over, I can't remember, I think it was 2 years ago, maybe 3 years ago, because COVID just messes up my timeline with memories now. But we went to when he was caddying for that Jason Norris, and he was over for the B&W Championship, the golf. And the Thursday, we went with Lowell, Gary, and Atters. Yep. And we had a pretty sensible day that day. And I think the next day, Birdie could get us, or Rod could get us through tickets for the Friday. And I think I blagged work. I think I had a sickie. Hopefully no one from work watches this. And me and Birdie went, and God, did we get smashed. We followed Jason Norris and Rod round. Yeah. And it was Jason Norris, who was, I don't know, 100 of in the world, and no one really knew him. And he's playing with an Italian bloke and a South Korean whose name was Wang. That was brilliant. A bloke whose name's Wang is good enough for me. I remember the second day when me and Birdie went and was smashed. Wang, oh, stop. The 18th year drive, none of them were making the cut. They're all massively over par. He hit a drive, and I've just gone, oh, stop it, Wang. All the caddies turned around laughing. It was brilliant. And then we met up with Rod after, and we went to this pub in Surrey, really nice pub, where all the caddies and a couple of golfers, neither of them made the cut, were all getting smashed. And even so, we're all talking about having great memories with Rod. And it's like, even to like at my age, I've still got great memories with getting smashed with Rod, as well as someone of like your age has. And the stretch of the generations in this club, and it doesn't matter what age you are, we can still sit here and get. I can go to that club on a Saturday, and I'll spend most of my time with. Like, I'll sit over there last season, spent most of my time with Kevin Horan and Darren Ivory getting pissed, rather than sitting with people my own age.
Yeah.
So it just shows how it doesn't matter who you are, where you come from, or how old you are. We everyone just gets along with it. It's like one big family, isn't it?
Another thing I'd say is that behind every club, you've got to have good administration. And Gary, you know, sort of set the standard when he was secretary for those, you know, all those early years. He was secretary for some considerable time. And at the start, you had Fred Morrison doing the books and just keeping things organised. And then Martin sort of took over from Fred later on. And Martin did treasurer's job for years. And then I think Brian Atkins succeeded Martin. He'd done that for years. And then later on, you've had, obviously, in recent years, now Sarah's the current occupant of the job. And then going back to the secretary's side, after Gary, Gary handed over to Steve Barlow, Rio, to his friends. And, you know, Rio done a sterling job for years as well. And, you know, kept everything running ship shape. And then Terry King came in. Terry's obviously another great friend of Gary and myself from school, as was Paul Cowley. You said Paul Cowley mentioned. Paul went to school with us as well. And we were lucky. We're so lucky. We had people who were dedicated, you know, and to the club. And then Terry was got us through the club mark, which I think, you know, with Terry working with
huge Oscar
and Martin again on the Colts side, they, you know, they sort of steered at the club, not only having the Colts section, but giving it a sense of authenticity, you know, the proper setup. And no one, you know, the other clubs could say, oh, Gorsbrook's a bucket shop, because we did the qualifications, we brought in the standards, and we not only adopted them, but we ran to them as well, you know, we adhere to those standards, which was really good. So parents could bring their kids along knowing it's safe and their kids can enjoy their cricket and in a safe environment. I think that's very important these days. You know, we've had to progress from the days when we're taking Scott, Darren and Lee and Danny Walker out and getting them drunk at 15 after a game. You wouldn't be allowed to do that now. You know, it's imagine the parents would be up in arms, but the world's moved on.
We do still do that. We've just got a certificate to say that we're not meant to, but we do it anyway.
Yeah. And then we got Jenny, bless her now, who's the current secretary. I don't know, sometimes I don't know if Sarah and Jenny know what they let themselves in for, but hopefully, you know, everyone can support them and they can carry on and become themselves, you know, long-standing servants in those particular roles. But so they've got hard acts to follow over the years. It's always been, you know, we weren't blessed with the internet, so things had to be done by paper, wasn't it, Gary? It was all letters and stamps and...
Oh, yeah, we used to steal photocopy in paper and envelopes and put things through franking machines at work when no one was looking. You did what you did.
Oh, dear. Yeah. We'd be sued tomorrow, too, wouldn't we?
I'm getting locked up for feeding underage kids alcohol. You still go to prison for nicking stamps.
You'll remember, Sam, we had all the gear stolen one, didn't we?
Sorry, Gary?
We had all the gear stolen one year as well. In my lockup where I was living, we had all the gear downstairs in the lockup and it got stolen.
Oh, yeah, that's right, yeah. And
it's gone.
Yeah, I seem to recall, yeah.
Yeah.
I'll mention the grounds while we're here, Gary. The grounds we played at. Which was your favourite ground?
I've got to say the Oval.
No, I'm talking about where you... Oh, here we go. I led him into that, didn't I? Yeah. Of the Gorsbrook grounds, though, Gary, aside from your days playing at the Oval.
I've got to say Old Church, because there was something about it. It was the time we were there, the weather was always good. And it was always blisteringly hot. And that pitch was just a batsman's paradise. And I liked it. That was my favourite ground.
I've got to say, I think I'm with Gary there as well. I liked Old Church as well.
It was just something about it. It was a nice little bar. And it just had everything we needed for it. And the pitch was just beautiful. He's got any wickets at you those years, but to move on.
Joe Harvey, the late Joe Harvey, used to be our groundsman over there, and Joe was a cricket man, you know, and he loved to make sure that wicket was done properly. And he had a big bust up at one point with the council because they were telling him he's got to slack on, you know, not give as much time to the wickets and cover about three different parks rather than just doing, you know, looking after Old Church Park. And I think he basically told them where to go and carried on looking after the wickets. And for the first period, he said, I'm not going to be able to walk the wicket. Do you remember, Gary? We all went over Old Church Park one night.
Yeah.
The bar was open. And the Foresters, as it was in the football club around the bar, and Ernie was behind the bar, and we just got the watering apparatus out, put it on the square, went and sat in the bar for 2 hours while we walked the square, because we promised Joe we'd do it, just to keep the, you know, the wicket up to standard.
We had to keep
always remember that, yeah, going over. And yeah. I think, yeah, Mount Baker's is a different gravy in terms of the conditions and everything.
Than absolutely,
the
yeah.
ground. But there was something more intimate about Old Church Park that, again, we played there a long time and, you know, many, many years. And I can remember, for example, Gary, going to the Rush Green Tavern after the bar shut at the Foresters, and we'd go down at about 9:30, we'd head down to down the road, watching the World Cup games, and then the year England got to the semi-final. And, you know, we were watching all the games down there for some reason. And it, they were great nights, you know, just happy memories.
Lots of good ones like that, weren't they? Yeah. I think that was my favourite ground.
Yeah. What about yours, Shan? Was yours the one where you scored your 100?
But favourite, you keep saying that, don't you?
Checked in the post.
Yeah.
am I sitting here with people that have scored hundreds and I haven't? Am I the odd man out?
I think you are, yeah.
You are, Shan, but you know.
You know it's bad when I can say, oh, even I scored 100, Shan. That's when you know it's bad.
Yeah. Oh, well, that's one pleasure I'll never get, so. Just to make a little point here, Gary. Who was the first bowler to take 6 wickets for Gorsbrook in a match?
That was you, Shan.
Just thought I'd get that in closing there, because I assume that I'm looking at the time.
You can have that one. You can have that one.
Yeah. Well, don't worry, we're keeping it under an hour, so we've just ticked over 11 a.m. here. Well, I'll edit that last bit out. At least we know where Joe gets his bowling skills from. Carry your handbag when you run into bowls, well, Shad. we'll wrap it up there, gents. So I suppose officially, I didn't plan this. We haven't got anything to give you in terms of being in the Gorsbrook Hall of Fame, apart from you're in the Gorsbrook Hall of Fame. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
We might see if we can do something. I'll leave that in Joe's incapable hands of seeing if we can put something official up. If we had our own clubhouse, it'd be brilliant. I can imagine we could put something up. But maybe that's for when I'm your age and you two are in your 90s. We're wheeling you around everywhere.
Pushing up the daisies then, really.
Yeah, exactly. We'll be waking you up when we do the official ceremony, because it's too...
All you need is a virtual clubhouse, right? That's what you need.
Exactly. Exactly that. But obviously, really appreciate your time. So what's going to happen now? Daniel Gillam's going to edit this, tidy it all up, hopefully. And then obviously, we'll get it sent out on the socials and what be it.
Okay, thank you.
No worries.
Excellent.
Good to see you both.